Hi guys, welcome back to GKCodelabs. Few of you have asked me that please suggest some laptops for data science or big data. So I thought of making a small video on this. For covering this small topic, I don't want to go with the direct recommendation of laptops that buy this, buy that. Rather, I would like to tell you the importance of each and every component, that what those few main components matter and why you should consider the technical numbers behind those components. So that will help you in taking your own decisions, that what laptop or what configuration will be better for your requirements. And also I will share what laptops configuration I recommend. So first let's see what components, basically what parameters we should consider before even thinking of buying a machine for data science. So components that we should mainly consider is, first is CPU, the most important. Second, GPU, the RAM or the memory, the storage, and the screen. So we'll discuss it one by one, that what are those technical specifications behind each of these components and how does that matter in our data science projects. So first let's consider CPU. So as we all know, most of our processes or whatever custom code that we are writing, most part of that gets executed on a CPU, and it needs the CPU to work, obviously. So whatever applications you are using, I'll consider only the data science application here. So whatever application or whatever library, in fact, let's take an example, you are coding, whatever IDE you are using, that is also an application. Apart from the application that you are building inside that IDE, and on top of everything, the operating system that is serving you everything. So every process is using some part of your CPU. That is why this is a component to consider. But what technical specification of this to be considered? That is the model of the CPU, the generation, and the frequency of the CPU. So overall, we have few varieties in the market as of now. That is, you can go with Intel Core i3, i5, i7, or these days AMD is coming up with the new generation process, that is Ryzen. So Ryzen 3, 5, 7, and so on. So let's take each of this component as per your different budgets. Budget may be the first criteria that you have to consider. If your budget is somewhere between 20 to 35, 40k, you can consider i3. If around 45 to 70k, then you can consider i5. Otherwise, you can consider i7. And the performance of your application will also decrease and increase as per your choice of these CPUs in your budget. So we cannot go much deeper into the CPU part, because CPU part is only your budget based. That what things will work, i3 will also work and i7 will obviously work. So CPU choice is totally on your budget, but I would say don't go below i3. And if you really have so much money to spend, you can take i7, but in my opinion that much is not required, because on your laptop you are using that only for practice and learning. A good powerful CPU is required, but anyways you are not going to do any production level activities on your local machine. For that everyone is using cloud, and i5 is more than enough for what I think. One more point, there are two kinds of CPUs in i5 and i7 also. The variants that end with U and the variants that end with H. Let me show you what CPU I am using. So if you can see here, my CPU is i5-8300H. So what this last letter means is the H stand for high-end graphics. So in i5 8th generation also, you might see some processors with ending with U and some ending with H. And in 7th generation, some were with HQ, that is a different part. But these days you might see the CPUs with 8300H and 8250 some other model with ends with U. So U is a bit underpowered CPU, and H is for high-end graphics. Mostly in the gaming laptops, you will see these H CPUs. So H version is always better, just keep that in mind. And this is the frequency or the clock speed, 2.30 gigahertz. The more this number in same generation, I'm telling. In same generation, if you find the number is more, the better the CPU. So moving on, let's come to GPU. So what is GPU? GPU is a graphical processing unit. That is what it stands for. And to explain it briefly, this is another processing unit. Like CPU, this is also a processor. As the CPU, you can say, these days have two cores or four cores, If you consider multi-threading, if a CPU has multiple threads, you can multiply those physical cores into multiple virtual cores. So in CPU, you can see we have, suppose if a processor is 2-core 4-thread or 4-core 8-thread, so that CPU can execute 2 process if multi-threading is enabled, then whatever number of threads that is per core. So 2-core 4-thread means that CPU can process 2 multiplied by 4, that is 8 processes at a time. But mostly this is a serial processing. But how GPU is different? GPU has many cores that are comparatively slower than the cores in CPU, but in numbers they are high. So like we have 2, 4, or 8 cores in CPUs, we have some hundreds or thousands of cores in GPU. So that is something different and interesting in case of GPU. So first point, it has more number of cores than CPU, and all the cores are slower than the ones in CPU. So what difference does it make? More number of slower cores in GPU to enables us to execute multiple processes in parallel, but those processes should require something, some static calculation or some symmetrical or same kind of computations. Because the cores are slower, and to process them efficiently, all those computations should be similar or symmetric. In for example, in data science, the advanced algorithms of text and image classification or data mapping and the regression algorithms, these algorithms, when we have to run on any data, this requires a similar computation. The computation logic does not differ much. Suppose in case of image classification, if a image classifier library is classifying an image and reading different pixels, and different neurons are classifying each pixel. So in that case, and all the pixels calculation is somewhat similar, that can be fed into GPU in place of CPU so that it can be processed parallelly, and the computation is mostly static. So we need not give this kind of task to CPU, which won't be that much efficient as it would be in a GPU. So this was a small idea behind the GPU. One thing to note, any computer cannot work without a GPU. So this is a fact actually. Every computer needs to have a GPU to run, at least CPU plus GPU. Even if you do not have any external graphics processor in your laptop, there is one graphic processor inside your CPU, that is Intel integrated graphics, if you see, and that is in AMD, that is AMD graphics. Every CPU has integrated graphics onto it. And if you are going for any laptop with external graphics, that will be an aid to the graphics processing power of your laptop. So here we have only 2 options basically, AMD and NVIDIA. Different version of AMD and NVIDIA are there that we will see once we discuss the recommended laptop. Now, third is RAM. Now, this is you all know, to store our running programs and whatever custom data that we are processing, that is in the middle. In case of Spark, as our series is going right now, all the computations that happen in memory, so that data is also to be stored. And whatever applications you are running, in case you are running some virtual machine or any software, some temporary data has to be stored somewhere, and that is where RAM comes into picture. So how much RAM you need, more important than that is what configuration of RAM you are using. So this will take some time, but understand this carefully. So you all know, right, as of now we can have 8 GB or 12 GB or 16 GB. We can have 4 GB, but please don't go with that. At least we should have 8 GB. You can have 12 GB or 16 GB, but the catch here is what configuration of RAM modules will you use to add up to these numbers. 8 GB you can have with 2 modules of 4 GB. This scenario you will have in 2 cases. First case is your laptop out of the box has 4 GB RAM and 1 slot empty, or there is single RAM module of 8 GB. Let me give you what I analyzed recently when I was buying the laptop. All the laptops between 20,000 to 30,000 or 32,000 will provide you mostly 4 GB of RAM, and 1 slot will be empty where you can add another 4 GB. Let me take 8 GB section first. You can add 8 GB after 4 GB, that will make 12, but we'll discuss it later. So in 30 to 35,000 range, you will have most of the laptops where there will be 4 GB module, and there will be 1 empty slot where you can add another module. But below 30, all the laptops obviously will have around 4 GB of RAM, but that RAM would be soldered to the motherboard. This is some new configuration that these days companies are coming with. you will have only one empty slot, that you should say it's fine, but other module will not be removable, that will be soldered. So in that case, if you want to go more than 8 GB, you have only one option. You have to mix 4 GB and 8 GB, 4 GB that is already built in, and you can go max to 8 GB or 16 GB in some case, which is I'll come to that why it is not efficient. So max to 8 GB you can add, that will make up to 12 GB. So in both these cases, either the first module is soldered or it is into a slot. As far as efficiency is concerned, you should try to get two modules of RAM of ATAR of same frequency without any doubt, and you should try, they should have same size also. So let's say you have two slots. First slot has 4 GB RAM and it is and the frequency of that is 2400 MHz. So what you should try, you should add only 4 GB module after that also for 2400 MHz. Do not add anything less than 2400. You can add more than that, but there is no use if you are paying extra for that more frequency, because the memory controller, in case it faces two memory modules of different frequencies, it will chop the numbers of the higher frequency RAM to the minimum one. So if you are adding 2400 MHz and 2888 MHz RAM, both RAM will run on 2400 MHz. So first point, you should try to have a RAM which is of same frequency of what was previously there. And second thing, the size. Size is where the 12 GB section comes in. Because for 12 GB, either you have 4 GB or 8 GB in your previous module. After that, you can add 4 GB or 8 GB. So 4 plus 8 or 8 plus 4 can only make 12. Here, once you have 4 GB in soldered form, in that case, you might want to choose the 8 GB RAM. So is it efficient? Is it correct to use? For most of the cases, yes, you can use it. There will not be much effect. But yes, it is a possibility that you are, in place of upgrading, you are downgrading your system. But let me tell you, I have personally tested it. These days, whatever motherboards we are getting, that don't create that kind of problem that you are downgrading it. Let me explain. So when you have two memories of same size and your motherboard supports a dual channel, what happens there is, you can see this small figure here. If your RAM is running in the single channel, the memory controller transfers the data from your CPU to your RAM using this one channel. So there is one channel that is the bandwidth of the which that can be used to transfer the data from your memory. But in case you have dual channel support, so the amount of data may be same, but there are two channels, so bandwidth will be more. There are two channels that can be used, so read and write will be faster. So this is the basic concept. Take an example of big data. Suppose you have 8 GB of RAM and you are writing 6 GB of data to your memory. So in that case, it might be possible, depends upon the other running program, but it might be possible that the memory controller decides to spill that 6 GB data, some part in your first memory module and some part in your second memory module. And that will be much faster to write, because considering one memory module, it has to write less amount of data than completely 6 GB into one module. Hope you get it. So dual channel support is always good. In case you have different size, that is, one is of 4 GB and another is of 8 GB, then what will happen? There is a special mode called flexi mode that some advanced motherboards support. What they do, if you have 4 GB and 8 GB, the half 4 GB of that 8 GB module will be run as a dual channel with the another 4 GB, and rest of the 4 GB will run in single channel. That is in some advanced motherboards. I don't think in this range laptop support that, but even if they don't support, they will run both the memory modules in single channel that were possibly able to run in dual channel if they were of same size. But so should you go for 12 GB? If you are running big VMs like Cloud Era Quick Start VM, then I would say yes, you can go with it. Because in those cases where you are running entire virtual machine on your laptop, in that case, I would say more room in the storage will probably help you rather than your memory getting choked up but running in dual channel. So that is also not very efficient. You are running both the modules in dual channel with 8 GB, but your memory is getting choked up to 7.8 to 7.9 GB, that you are not able to feed resources to your operating system, that is the foundation of running all that. So sometimes it is better to have more room, even that small negligible slowness should not matter. For VMs, I'm saying 12 GB, if your budget is that much, you can go for it. There is no issues. And another is 16 GB. The concept is same. 8 × 2, that is 8 GB RAM mostly you will get in high-end laptops also. So you should consider upgrading it. But while upgrading, keep all that points which I mentioned, keep that in head. Go for another module which is of same frequency and probably same size. For high-end machines, let's say i5 with i5 processors, they support two memory slots, so there is no issue. And again, there is no need for going more than 16 GB in my opinion. That is still up to you, but 8 plus 8 is more than enough because they are of same size and more than enough for any kind of computation. But frequency you should keep in mind, that should be same. So enough on RAM. Let's consider storage. This is simply to store your data. But out of that also, if you can go for SSD, that will be a great help. SSDs make a big difference for those who use their laptop very readily. Right now they are using for 2 hours, then they have to go somewhere, come back again, run the same applications again. So in that cases, it is very less troublesome if you have SSD. HDDs are of two types. Budget laptops, you will get 5400 RPM. In high-end laptops, if they are providing HDD, you will have 7200 RPM. And in SSDs, there are two kind. One is M.2 SATA and one is M.2 PCIe NVMe. NVMEs are slightly more expensive, far more expensive, I would say. And M.2 SATA is slightly cheaper. So depending upon your budget, both are fine, but at least go for an SSD. For my laptop, I am using 128 GB PCIe NVMe SSD. If you can go for 256 GB, that will be better in my opinion. 128 GB is a bit less, but 128 GB laptops mostly have additional HDD with them. But for SSD, if you have 256 GB, whether or not you have the HDD, it will suffice for your needs. That is my opinion, because these days nobody stores huge games, movies and big data sets into their machine. For that, they use external hard drive. So 256 GB is more than enough. Anything more than that is up to you. Then let's discuss screen, which is a pretty important part, and only consider this if your budget is good, something above 50k. Below than that, you don't have many options, but anyways, you have options for 720p, 1080p with 60Hz, 120Hz, 144Hz, and after that 4K, 5K and whatnot. 720p I won't recommend much because starting from 28,000 to 29,000, you start getting HD screens. Full HD screens. So it's better to go with the full HD screen in my opinion, because in 720p screens, not only the clarity that seems to be substandard, also due to this resolution, the screen cannot accommodate most of the important part in some of the big cloud UIs, because I use Microsoft Azure for my official purpose. So when I used to have a 720p screen, there was much of scrolling and dragging just to view few components. So in my opinion, at least 1080p you should have. And in most of the gaming laptops, you'll find starting 1080p with 60Hz. In few of the advanced one, you might also see 120, and in few of the premium laptops, you'll find 144Hz also. So that was all basically on the components that we should consider. A few additional points. What OS you should use? There are some laptops with pre-installed Windows. So is it any harm in that? Maybe some of you will be some die-hard Linux fans. That is your choice if you are comfortable with Windows. But one point I would like to share. See, I also work on Linux most of my big data purpose. I have seen two kinds of Linux users. First one is truly they understand what they are handling, what they are actually doing. And they are a bit of control freaks, so they like Linux, but that reason. But majority of users that I have seen personally are Linux fans under some peer pressure, that that guy is using Linux and that sounds cool, so I'll also use it. The same people, without knowing what they are doing, they are hitting sudo before any command that otherwise it's not going to work, and struggling with all their graphics drivers, wireless drivers. So really, I mean, if you are in learning phase, do not get into peer pressure and use Linux even for your personal use if you don't need it. And at any point of time, if you have Windows, a powerful machine, You can use Linux on your virtual machine, and still if you have some OCD for Linux, you can do a dual booting. That is every time possible, so no issues there. And for them who are going with lower end machines which do not provide Windows but they want to use, I would seriously request you don't go for piracy. Not because I'm talking this on my channel and I don't want to promote it, obviously I don't, but it's for your safety. I mean, when we were kids we used to do that with Windows XP, Windows 7, but these days where internet has already so much penetrated into our societies, consider not pirating it, because nothing is for free, and if you are using a cracked version of Windows or any particular software, you are stepping into big vulnerabilities these days. So for people who are going with budget segment and Windows is not already installed, they can either buy OEM keys that are these days available in somewhere around 800 to 1000 rupees. That is not much. Or in that case, they can go for a very user-friendly Linux distribution, that is Ubuntu. It's better you learn something and it's all free. Second thing is battery backup. If you have to travel a lot, I need not elaborate on this much. But if you have to travel a lot, just see in the reviews what battery backup other customers are telling you that it has. So one point to consider, and a few people consider some brands. So as of now, in my opinion, I don't think all the brands are doing better than each other. So I don't have any brand in particular. Until and unless you choose a good configuration, everything should work fine. So let's see what recommendations I have for all the configurations that I discussed. First, for the budget segment, I would suggest you either Aspire 3, a model with 8th generation i3-8145U. This is again a U version processor, as I told you how that makes the difference. 4GB of RAM. In 28,000 to almost 35,000, you won't get more than 4GB. There are one or two exceptions, I'll tell. But apart from that, you won't get more than 4GB. But it has 256GB of SSD. As I told, if you are getting 256GB at least, that may compensate for some of your less RAM in terms of snappy performance. Not that it can load more into the RAM, but in terms of snappy performance, it SSD can compensate more than more RAM. So in budget segment, in my opinion, this is one laptop that can be considered. The second one is Lenovo S145. There, do small research, because this model S145 available in 8th generation also. Right now I could not find that. I'm personally using that as my secondary laptop, that is i3 8th generation, and this is a full HD, which matters. And this particular model in Amazon right now, the 4GB variant is available, but for the same price, or 29,000 or somewhere around 30,000, you can find the 8GB model. Please see that in some sale. Diwali sale is already over. Please see if some sale comes around Christmas. You'll find the 8GB variant of this. That is around 1500 to 2000 rupees more. And take that one. I'm just showing you as far as the model is concerned. Please search for S145, that is 8GB with i3 8th generation. So this is the second laptop that I would recommend in budget segment. Now if you have slightly premium budget, we can come to i5. In i5, I would recommend Asus Tough Gaming Series, the laptop that I'm using right now. This is a previous version to this, but this comes with i5 8th generation, 1TB HDD and 256GB of SSD. Whatever I am using is the previous version, and it has 128GB SSD, but now they are providing 256GB, and this 256GB is NVMe SSD. So it has 4GB graphics, and this particular model has Nvidia GeForce 1050. You will also find 1050 Ti, which is the next version of this graphics card. So try to go for that. See, the laptops in these range are available in many configurations, even when the model number is same. There is some sub model number that they provide to those configuration laptops. So as I've told you the importance of all the components, please, if you are sticking to any model that I am recommending, do a little more research when you plan to buy them. The second I would recommend in i5 series is Asus ROG Strix G. It comes with i5 9th generation, that is the latest generation. Actually 10th generation is also available, but it is not in Indian market as of now. So this also comes with 8GB RAM. All these laptops will be in 8GB versions. For 16GB out of the box, you will have to go somewhere above 90,000. But I don't recommend that. 8GB DDR4 RAM these days can be found in somewhere around 3 to 5,000 rupees. So please don't spend much money just to take the same configuration out of the box. It has 512 GB SSD, Windows 10, 4 GB graphics. And here, if you see, this has NVIDIA GeForce GTX 1650. So that is above 1050 or 1050 Ti. And it is available near about same price. And these prices are expected to reduce to a great extent in those Amazon and Flipkart sales. So try to buy them in those sales. After i5, if you want to go to i7, again Asus and Lenovo's in this range, they provide better configuration. Same model is available in i7, that is 9th generation, and other configuration are almost same. So if you want, please go for i7. Not required essentially, but it's up to you. This you can consider, or Lenovo Legion, that also similar configuration you can consider. That these are good laptops. Acer also provides same configuration in some premium amount, here in 75,000. Same configuration, Core i7 9th generation and 8 GB, 256 GB. Just see what suits your budget. And also, if you are a Apple fan, there is no other choice than MacBook Pro. Now it is available with the i9 processor. This is i7. Currently, this is available in i9 processor also. So there is nothing much to discuss for two reasons. Very less people go for this range, and there is very less customization that is possible. So if you have to go for MacBook Pro, there is nothing to discuss much. Just try if you can have a graphics processor and at least 16 GB of RAM. So that was all, guys. That was my recommended laptops and configurations. I hope I was able to explain you well, not only the configurations, but what configuration actually will make the difference and some technical stuff behind that. If you like this video, please hit that like button, and please subscribe to my channel if you have not already done. See you in my next video. Thank you.